Great to have you back on The Breakfast here on PLOS TV Africa. Our next conversation moves to talk about Nigeria's economy in 2022 and, of course, the prospects that it might have. As the National Assembly has passed the 2022 budget of 17.126 trillion naira. We're speaking this morning with an economic analyst, Mr. Mukhtar Mohammed. Good morning, Mr. Mohammed. Thanks for joining us.
Always my pleasure to be here. Good morning. Compliments of the season.
Same to you. I saw something that I was just going to quickly share, you know, just a line that I want you to respond to. It says, an expansionary budget should stimulate growth, create jobs, increase output, reduce poverty, and of course, also push infrastructural growth. When you hear these things, do you have these same expectations, you know, for the 2022 budget?
Definitely not. I may have had those expectations when I saw the budget as was released by the presidency, where they tried to make sure that the oil benchmark was put as low because of the volatility. And also they tried to look at how to reduce debt servicing. I think I agree with all those points, but immediately went to the National Assembly, the budget has been jacked up. And most jacked up for project we don't know. They talk about constituency project, they talk about giving money for agricultural expansion. And so you just wonder. I think I was thinking for the first time, because the government was very conservative in their budget projection, especially in the oil benchmark, I thought for the first time the legislators and the executive would be on the same page. But unfortunately, they have done what they normally do, and which is normally to jack up the price, put in project that we don't know, put in project that they won't tell us, and sometimes they go as far as putting in state project into federal project. So it's shocking, but that is what it has always been when it comes to budgetary in Nigeria.
Well, but it doesn't really change much, you know, between the 16 trillion naira and the 17 trillion naira. Let's look at what the president, you know, at first had sent to the National Assembly. Just a little above 16 trillion naira. Would that have been more exciting? And why do you think that maybe would have made more sense without the additions from the National Assembly?
Remember, you're talking about 16 trillion. You're talking about not 17 trillion. That's almost 1 trillion added to it. That's not small when it comes to economic terms. That is huge. Do you know what 1 trillion would have done? And being in the savings of the Nigerian coffer, especially the reserve, what would have happened to us if we have 1 trillion that is saved for the future generation? Even if it is to pay the debts that this government is already incurring for the future generation, do you know what that would do for Nigeria? Look, it's all about a strategy. It's all about what are your programs, what are your vision. Budget is the roadmap towards actualizing your electoral promises or your vision. So, and once budget becomes a subject of controversy, where we have to go back and forth, then it's not meeting the required target any longer. And you need to look at budget in Nigeria has never met expectation. When you're talking, like you're talking about in terms of job creation, infrastructural development, let's look at the area of job creation. It has never met it. Even this present year's is worse, with about 70% Nigerians, youth. You're talking about youth, 70% unemployed, about 40% underemployed. So you see, that's a time bomb. And the legislators are not looking at pouring this money into area that will create jobs. They are looking at pouring this money into area that will benefit them in the long run, to say, during his time at the National Assembly, he was able to achieve this. Remember, this is going to be the last budget that they are going to have, that is going to run a full year for them. So come 2023, we will have an abridged budget, or we might not even have a budget, pending what the administration decides.
This is what I'm trying to clarify, because, you know, from your earlier statements, you said, you know, that you may have had some hope until you saw the additions that were made and how, you know, they weren't necessarily put in the right direction. So did the initial budget seem like it was going to achieve much for Nigeria, the initial one that was sent to the National Assembly?
Yes, especially in the area of debt servicing and oil benchmark. That was what excited me. The oil benchmark was very conservative.
At $57 a barrel.
$57 per barrel. And at the time they did this, the oil benchmark at that time was over 70-something dollars per barrel. And remember that for the previous two budgets that we passed into law, at the time the president still was putting the oil benchmark at $60 per barrel. And when the president was making the budget, the oil benchmark was even $58 per barrel. This is the first time we are being very conservative. And no, now listen, the difference between $57 per barrel would have been going into our excess crude account, which would have been something that we could use into generating the sovereign wealth fund for development of key infrastructural projects. Like they are involved in the development of the second Niger Bridge. You know what that would have done? That would have reduced the debts in terms of debt servicing to the Nigerian government. So that was what really excites me about the budget. I remember that in terms of debt servicing, in previous budget, we were doing like for every one Naira Nigerian earned, we use like 80 kobo to service debt. But in this budget, we're looking at for every one Naira we earn, we're looking at using 60 kobo to service debt. Those were things that were exciting me about the budget going forward. But like I said, the legislators have always done what they know how to do best.
Okay, so let's also look at some other issue. The Center for Promotion of Private Enterprise is saying that the 2022 budget will be very difficult to fund. And that's for them. They are saying that the budget is very ambitious. It does not reflect the current realities of our country. And looking at the fact that debt servicing, we're looking at 3.61 trillion naira. I want you to share your thoughts on this. Do you agree with this group of persons?
I agree with them. I remember that they didn't say this when the president passed the budget. I mean, read the budget to the National Assembly. They are saying it now after the legislature have passed the budget. Because if you look at the budget that was passed by the president, it was very conservative. It was realistic, especially, like I say, in the terms of benchmark oil price and other indices. It was very realistic, and even in debt servicing. But what we've seen the legislators done is to jack it up and make it very, very unrealistic, over-ambitious. I agree with them totally.
So do you think it's difficult to fund the budget?
Even the previous budget that was going to be passed, was going to be difficult to fund. We're already thinking of borrowing to fund those budgets in other areas. But in terms of borrowing, we're looking to borrow to fund the budget in terms of infrastructure. Talk less of now that it's going to be most difficult because they've jacked it up. So it's going to be more difficult. It's the ruling government. I don't expect the presidency to sign this budget into law. But if it does, I they always have an agreement. I sign it supplementary budget later. Maybe that is what will happen. But looking at the budget as it stands now, I don't think it's implementable at all.
All right. Speak a little bit more. Mr. Mohammed, speak a little bit more about, you know, the plans to, to fund this budget, you know, and raise revenue. President Muhammadu Buhari, of course, the current administration and their plans to generate or to grow revenue to fund the budget are talking about tax waivers here and there. They're also talking about enhancing taxes, improving custom revenue through tech and some other things. Do you hear any of these? And it seems like these might be ways that will, actually increase or grow revenue for Nigeria to fund this budget.
No. You see, what government is doing, government is just thinking of revenue. I've said it on your program before. I mean, using taxes as a way of raising revenue is ancient these days. What every reasonable economy does these days is looking at using tax as a revenue to grow the economy. If you look at this current budget, realistically budgets, I mean, whatever they call it, it's all about revenue. It's all about customs, all about FIRS, all about federal income tax revenue rates, it's all about capital acquisition revenue. It's all about revenue. And when you talk about revenue, you're just thinking of raising funds to do your own project. Nobody's looking at the businesses that are going to bring this revenue. How can we help these businesses? When you're talking about tax waivers, how many really SMEs have really gotten tax waivers? Most of the tax waivers you see are actually those that are close to government and are able to pull their way through government to get the tax waivers. We are not seeing developing companies. We are not seeing companies that are creating jobs coming into this country and you're giving them tax waivers, tax holiday for the next 3 to 4 years. All we see is that in businesses that are there, you are putting more taxes on them. You are just thinking of that. Look, in a more developed economy, what we think about is job, using your tax revenue as a means to create job. And how do you do that? When you do that, when you give them tax bracket, they are able to employ more people. Remember, the people they are employing from are not exempted from paying tax. So you have a snowball effect. The more of your citizens that are employed, the more tax you collect. But it's unfortunate that this government, since its inception, has never think of looking at tax as a means to grow the economy. All they say about is tax as a means of revenue to develop to fund their own project that they think Nigeria needs, not really how to grow these businesses that will in turn be able to bring taxes and those projects will be formed realistically.
Okay, so this is also another part of, you know, budgeting that always concerns a lot of economic experts. I'd like you to share your thoughts on that. Just yesterday, while we were just talking about it on the side, again, the capital expenditure is pegged at 4.89 trillion, and you have the recurrent capital or expenditure at 6.8 trillion naira. And you can actually see that we're going to pay more attention in recurrent expenditure rather than capital. But some people are saying that this is actually an increase after 4 years, 60% increase. I'd like you to share your thoughts on that as well.
When you look at that, couple with part of a government that was telling us they are going to reduce expenditure. Remember, they went to even sometime the president was saying that we don't need six private jets. That we're taking in up about, we may be selling some of those jets to make sure we get revenue to reduce recurrent expenditure has always been the talk of this government. When you talk about recurrent expenditure, you begin to ask yourself, who are those people that are doing this recurrent expenditure? Why is it always jacking up? You look at it's all from the presidency to the legislators. It's not even the civil servant because you cannot say they have employed most civil servants. Remember, there's an embargo on employment. So it's all about themselves because when you talk about, I always like making this scenario. Why does the president of the Federal Republic of Nigeria need to sue media advisors? Why does he have a senior special advisor, then he have a special advisor on media, then he have a senior special advisor on media? That senior special advisor will have his own PE, that PE will have his own secretary. Look, it's all about using recurrent expenditure as a means of social investment whatever you call it, or we call it like they call it a local palace stomach infrastructure, because all they think about is how many of the people that helped me come to power can I give political appointment, and in turn they are going to be paid. So it's not about the people. You're looking at a recurrent expenditure being jacked up for almost 60% by 2 trillion. It is not done anywhere. And how many Nigerians are going to benefit from this? So it's surprising that the government that have proud itself to be one of the government that will come the most prudent in the history of Nigeria have turned out to be the government that every year we keep seeing an increase in current expenditure.
Yeah, but you know, in fairness, you know, and maybe you could also advise on this one. You know, you would expect, you know, for an economy that wants to grow, that there would be more interest in capital expenditure instead of recurrent. But can we afford to increase the figures, you know, for our capital expenditure without borrowing more?
No, we cannot. Even in the area of capital expenditure, we cannot. And you have seen that. But the only thing I always say is that we should do the public-private partnership, or PPP, whereby the government in turn provides their own, they bring their own project as their own capital into this project. And you tell the private sector, look, you're going to build this project, you're going to build and maintain for the next 25 years. And after that 25 years, government will take it over. So what government is doing is using the project as like a warranty or like a guarantor that, okay, you can take it, you develop it, we don't have to spend. So that government can use this money also in developing or in meeting other social investments for the people. That's what I expect to do, especially during the what we've suffered all over the world because of the pandemic. So but I'm surprised that we are not looking at that. Even when we are looking at that, it's even the private sector that in turn going to government to ask for that, which you see in terms of the Enugu road in the south is that MTN have decided the Dangote also have taken over some roads. So I expect that government should have been reaching out, and that is what we talk about tax bracket. Look, you develop this road, we are going to give you a bracket for social year. You take care of this power project. This is what you are going to enjoy from us. So that is what PPP. That's the new model operandi in terms of every developed economy, even the developing economy. If you look at the American infrastructure bill, that is what they are trying to achieve also using the PPP. So for me, I think that is the only way that will get more projects done and then not also involving us taking more loans for the financing of this project.
Okay, so just still on that, what would be the implication of this on the economy come 2022? I mean, the fact that we're going to be paying more attention to recurrent expenditure rather than capital expenditure, would there be an implication for that?
Big implication. Not to forget that 2022 is an election year. You should have that in the back of your mind. And governance take the back seat. I don't expect to see governance after the first 3 to 4 months of this year. Then you see governance take the back seat, and politics become the talk of the town, become the talk of the day. And also, you mustn't forget that even the government have seen that. Maybe the government have read that. That's why they are saying that we want to extend the lifespan of the 2021 budget to March, because they know that governance will take the back seat. So what are we going to expect? I don't think there will be anything. Rather, you see more recurrent expenditure, there are more political appointees for those that are going to leave government, are trying to also see how they can pacify those that they didn't pacify for the past 8 or 4 years. And also for those that want to come back, they'll also be using that as a yardstick also to make people vote for them, to getting some people get back to the political center stage. So governance is going to take the back seat. But the only thing about we talk about this economy, that is why we say the CBN, that is supposed to be the monetary policy, have become both the monetary and physical policy. So that is where you see the CBN begin to function, doing both what the physical should be doing. They will do both the monetary and the physical policy because they know governance will take the back seat. That is the only positivity that I can see come up in 2022. Maybe the CBN will begin to do more direct intervention, even if we have our reservation on that, is better than nothing.
Well, one thing that we don't speak about enough is implementation of each year's budget. You know, we're not sure how much 2020 budget was implemented. And of course, you know, pretty much the same thing will happen to 2021. Mr. Mohammed, do you think that if we can truly pump in 4.89 trillion naira of our capital expenditure into Nigeria's infrastructure every year, we will actually see a difference?
Definitely, if we do that completely, if we do that holistically, if we do that without political undertone, if we do that without any corruption embedded in it, we would have been seeing that. And you need to give it to this administration. I keep saying in terms of infrastructure, they have done very well. Even if they borrow today, you could see that some of this infrastructure, you could see them with your physical eye compared to before when you get some money. But never, you should always remember the slogan that was once said by one of the former ministers and also a politician that said, budget approved is not money released. So money release is always a problem because sometimes these budgets are approved, but there's, like you said, there's no capital to back up the implementation of this budget. And also not to forget that sometimes, especially when it comes to infrastructure, it's only in Nigeria that you see the government would have given the project before they begin to ask for the visibility study, the design for this project. Other in a developed company, you know that you're going to pass a budget for a project. You need to call the company that want to bid for this project. You need to negotiate with them. After the negotiation, you need to approve their plan and everything. That's when you take it to the National Assembly for approval. Yes. But our own is the other way around. You approve before you ask people to come and bid. And that's why we have the challenges that we normally have.
So what would be the high point for you of the 2022 budget? And if we have to go back in time, if, you know, probably correct one or two, what would be the area that you want us to pay attention to?
Number one, the area I want to pay attention to is let's reduce our benchmark on oil. Let's make it as low as possible so that we can have money to save for the future generation. That's how great economies have grown. That's how the economy in Dubai has grown. That's why the economy in Qatar has grown. That's how most developed economy, especially oil-driven economy, have been able to grow. They use those benchmarks, use those revenue that are saved in terms of their benchmark to begin to develop other stream of income, which in turn, when there's volatility in this sector, those are those streams that comes in to help them. Unfortunately, we are not doing that. That is what I want the government to do. Then I want to see the PPP, more private sector coming in the area of infrastructural development, while government save their revenue for social investment that will reduce the rate of poverty in the land. For me, if we can do these two key things, I can tell you, it won't be long. Prosperity will be in the land.
How would you rate our or the current administration's moves towards diversifying our economy. It was one of the things that, you know, was said a lot in 2015 and also in 2019. We have just, you know, a little above a year before the next elections. Do you think that they've done well enough with diversifying our economy, or we're still where we were?
You said 2015, you said 2019. Remember, 2015, why did they say that? The price of oil, crude, was about $40, $35 when they came. They were shouting diversification. 2019, why did they say that? The price of food came down. The pandemic was there. They start shouting diversification. Once the price of food had gone to 70 to 80, how much noise did we have about diversification? So diversification has become in lip services. The only place that we see diversification work is those diversification that we see direct intervention by the CBN, especially the anchor borrowing scheme that had to do with the rice production. You also we see diversification in the area of wheat production that they are trying to do. We see diversification in other you need to give it that in terms of the non-oil revenue, it has been one of the best so far, thus far, because we've seen that oil in the last report that was given by NBC, oil was even contributing more. I mean, non-oil sector was contributing more in positive terms to the negativity that we saw in the oil sector. So when you look at that, but you need to say that those are things, those interventions have come from the monetary policy instead of the fiscal policy. You could imagine if the fiscal and monetary policy are on the same page, the same synergy in terms of implementation of projects, whether monetary or fiscal, then would have seen astronomical growth. Have they done well? I think they've done the best they can in terms of in the non-oil sector. I think they tried in that way. But would they have done better? They would have done better if they really have matched their words with action, especially times when the price of crude was at its lowest ever. But again, you must realize that what we need to know is that it's just like you working in an establishment and you are earning revenue. Your key revenue is where you are working, so the salary they pay you in the month. What you do with your salary in the month is to diversify into other streams of income so that it will augment your salary. So our key driver is still oil, so we cannot run away from that. But what do we do? We use that oil to begin to develop other sectors. That is what we have not done thus far.
So why has that been, a major concern for us and an issue? Because we, of course, this morning we hear that the government is making plans to, launch the National New Development Plan and what have you. And the talk for diversifying the economy would always come with development plans. So that has been ongoing with successive government. You've had from 1966, thereabout, shortly after trying to recover from the Civil War, up until, this point. So you have different agendas, the different development plans. And why have we been able to, have a handle on diversification?
Nigeria has not developed good documents. We always have the documents. Go back to the farm. They need documents, the economic recovery good plan. Those plans have always been there. So we have not been developed documents. So let nobody think that you can bully us with documents, that all the documents. No. I think what we have been devolved is the political will or the infrastructure, the political will to implement or the structure to implement some of this document. Now, you're talking about a 5-year developmental plan that the government is trying to launch. Remember that we have the economic recovery good plan that was supposed to be one of the pillars of this administration, was supposed to be like a 10-year plan. That plan has its default, even until it took the world's richest man, then Bill Gates, to pick a hole in that economic recovery group plan before the government took it up and said they're taking it to the laboratory. And now we're coming from the laboratory, we are creating a 5-year developmental plan. And what we keep saying is that in terms of plan is not the problem. What are the structures that you have put in place that these plans are implementable? That is the major challenge. You don't just drive up a white elephant project and you don't even have the manpower, you don't even have the financial capability to go. So in terms of that, I think it's lack of political will. And again, it's lack of government ready to do the work. Government is not ready to do the work. Remember that it doesn't take them so much. You just take our food outside, you get the revenue. But when you're talking about diversification in the non-oil sector, you need to do the work. You need to meet the people. You need to begin to think out of the box. And that is one area that governance is not good at thinking out of the box. All they think about is what is the easier way out of a problem. So that's why we've had those problems, because we've not had a government that begins to think out of the box and begin to see how we can grow this non-oil sector. And when you want to grow the non-oil sector, then you need to look at the informal sector. When you are looking at the informal sector, you need to look at infrastructure. So that is why it has been a big challenge for us.
Well, Mukhtar Mohammed, like you've projected and like you've said, let's enjoy the first 3-4 months of 2022 before politicking starts. Hopefully, you know, there would be some benefits from the budget that we would enjoy before we are all, you know, put on the back seat for politics. Thank you very much for your time this morning, and compliments of the season once again. Have a very interesting Christmas.
And I like your Christmas outfit. I wish I could put one on.
Thank you.
You can. Good morning once again.
All right.
All right, and this is where we end the conversation this morning. A couple of days to Christmas. We're wishing you a very, very interesting celebration in the next week plus, all the way till the new year. But of course, remember to stay with us every day. And if you missed out on any parts of our conversation, it's simply at Plus TV Africa on Facebook and Instagram. Same with our YouTube channel.
Yes, at Plus TV Africa Lifestyle. And do not forget to always protect yourself, wear your nose mags, respect the social distancing, and be paranoid with washing your hands. I am Messi Hopo.
To have a great day. I am Osaogie Ogbonwa.